सबसे
Am I audible to all?
Yes, you are audible. Varun Dev sir, you are
principal sir. Am I audible?
No.
Yes, yes, sir.
Hello.
Hello. Am I audible, sir?
Audible, audible.
Dr. Varun Dev sir.
Yes. Good morning. I am here.
Yes. Good morning,
good morning
sir.
Very good morning. Very good morning. It is now 11 a.m. and we are going to start our webinar. Very good morning to all of you. I, on behalf of Communication Department, Bauda College, welcome all resource persons and our assistant coordinator, including our technical expert and their participants. Welcome to this national webinar organized by the Communication Department of Bauda College on the very topic, Prospects and Challenges for India in post-COVID-19 era. COVID-19 has brought an unprecedented situation to the world. Originated in Wuhan province in China, this pandemic has altogether changed the relations among nations. Everything became unusual. So long people have ignored the basic concept of hygienic, but this pandemic has taught us to become hygienic. From the perspective of India, it has brought many changes ranging from health, trade and commerce, social relations, tourism, educational, etc., etc. During this pandemic, a huge loss of economic development in India is witnessed. A huge number of laborers migrated from one place to another to save their life. Equally, they have lost their livelihood. Lakhs of people have died in the entire world. Even so-called developed nations failed utterly to combat this pandemic. But this challenge has to be overcome. A new way of thinking is emerged, particularly in educational field. Students are being connected through online classes and webinar is being organized in different parts of the country to understand the prospects and challenges during this pandemic. New innovative practices has come to the forefront. A holistic view is to be taken to understand the different problems. So it is our little effort to understand the prospects and challenges for India in post-COVID-19 era. This is why this webinar is being organized by our department. We are glad to inform you that more than 250 participants have participated in this webinar, not only from India, but from abroad, from Nigeria, Indonesia, etc. So with these few words, I conclude my speech and I request for principal, honorable principal.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You can.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, sir.
Everyone is fine. On behalf of our Bauda College family, I welcome all the participants across the globe and most welcome to our esteemed resource person, Dr. Varun Dev, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Dibrugarh University, Dibrugarh. The topic of today's webinar is Prospects and Challenges for India in post-COVID-19 era is very much relevant in this period. In post-COVID-19, India faced several challenges for which fall in financial market, disruption in international trade and transport, devaluation of their currencies due to export control and contraction in global market. As the novel coronavirus 19 rapidly spread across the world, the global economy is falling into an unprecedented disruption and recession. The International Monetary Fund has cut 1.9% as it earlier estimated of 5.8% in this year. Moreover, the rule of India plays in all post-pandemic world order will be determined by how we deal with the crisis now and how we emerge from it, which is spread and certain fundamental factors and quality of leadership, the quality of administrative and all levels, such as center, state, district, and village level, the quality of healthcare and our social coherences as people. So we hope that today's webinar is very relevant in the present scenario and everyone is benefited. Our estimate resource person will definitely boost very beautiful and enlightening knowledge regarding this topic. So I especially thanks to honorable resource person to today's webinar. I am very much thankful to Department of Political Science and IQSC Bohla College organized this topic of the webinar. At last, I hope that it would be very beautiful and fruitful sessions for all the participants have. With this, I have inaugurated this webinar and request to coordinator to continue with sessions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Sibani Phukan to give a welcome address to all.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So may I start? A very good morning to all of you. So first of all, let me introduce. I'm Dr. Shivani Phukan. I'm working in the Department of Political Science, Borhula College. And here in this virtual platform, I am here to welcome you all. So first of all, I want to welcome our principal sir, who is the inaugurator of today's webinar. I welcome Dr. Varun Day, Assistant Professor, Department of Political Science, Dibrugarh University. I welcome my colleagues of different departments of Borhula College. And finally, I welcome all those participants who have been registered for this webinar and are joining with us. So as we all know that the COVID pandemic situation has created a havoc among us and we are socially detached from each other. So we are unable to meet each other. We are unable to connect each other. So in such situation, we don't have other alternative than online seminar, online workshop, and online symposium. So this webinar, today's webinar, is also has been taken as an initiative by the Department of Political Science, Borhula College, in collaboration with IQSC, Borhula College. As we all know that the COVID pandemic situation has badly affected our industrial sector, our commercial sector, our health sector, our educational sector. Whole the development sector has been collapsed because of this international pandemic situation. So we have chosen this topic, the prospects and challenges for India in post-COVID-19 period. And as we all know that a large number of marginalized group of people, a large number of vulnerable group of people, they have lost their daily livelihood. So it is very much important for our policymakers, our leaders, our government to take such initiatives so that these people can rebuild their livelihood. A large number of wage earners, they have migrated from their workplace to defend their home place. They have lost their wages. They have lost their daily livelihood. So in such situation, what are the measures we should take after or in the post-COVID-19 period? It is a very much challenging task. So I hope that Dr. Borunde, our resource person, will highlight on these measures, on these issues. What should we do in post-COVID-19 period? So today's webinar is on prospects and challenges for India in post-COVID-19 period. And this webinar has been organized by the Department of Political Science, Bohula College. However, at this moment, I want to take the privilege to introduce you our college and our department. The Bohula College is situated at the Assam-Nagaland border. It is situated in the district of Assam. The college was established in 1990, and from the establishment, the college has taken different initiatives for the development and for the betterment of the student community of entire Borhula area. So our department has also taken different initiatives, and today's webinar is a academic activity for the development of the Borhula area, for the student of our student community of our college, and for the whole participants who are joining with us. So at this moment, I am very grateful to Mirazul Hussain Borloi sir and our IPSC coordinator, Dr. Rana Bora, for their systematic effort to make this webinar successful. I hope our participants will be benefited. So I welcome you all once.
Thank you, Dr. Shivani Phukan. You have highlighted many things in your welcome address. Now I request our honorable resource person, Dr. Borunde, to deliver his speech. Over to Dr. Borunde, sir.
Sir, his voice is not clear, sir.
So, very good morning to all of you. The academic fraternity of Borhula College.
No, sir, your voice is not coming clearly, sir. Please. Yeah, audible, but voice is not clear, sir. Voice is like fragmentation, like it's coming like fragmentation in fragmented way, sir. Yes, sir. Hello. Voice is coming, but it's in breaking. It's breaking in way, sir. Your voice.
Okay. So good morning to you all. And my friend Shivani, and the entire fraternity of Borhula College. I take this opportunity to thank the entire community of Borhula College for giving me this opportunity to express my views on India's position in the world order.
Sir, voice is not clear, sir. I don't know. No, sir, it's
Now, are you getting me now?
Yes, yes, sir. Now your voice is clear, sir. Yes.
Are you getting me now?
Yes, yes, sir. Your voice is now clear, sir.
Okay, okay, okay. Okay. So I thank all of you, the teaching fraternity of Borhula College, for giving me this opportunity to express my views on this, the issue of India's position in post-COVID. So we all are aware that the COVID-19 has, you know, made us to rethink everything, you know, from different perspectives. The whole life has got a sea change. COVID-19 has brought sea change in our personal life, in our social life, in our economic life, in our political life, not necessarily only within India, but elsewhere also, throughout the country, I mean throughout the world. And in one sense, we can say that COVID-19, which has been, you know, witnessed by the mankind. Parallelly, it has paralyzed the entire activities of the world, more or less. Therefore, it has brought number of issues in the forefront to be discussed, to be rediscussed, to be interpreted, to be reinterpreted in different ways, right? And now the main question to address here is post-COVID era or post-COVID world order in international relations. Now see, this is very important. As I have said, that it's post-COVID world and post-COVID era. Now, to understand the dynamics of post-COVID era, basically, we need to understand what exactly, you know, accentuated us to tell post-COVID era. What exactly made us to think about post-COVID era? There will be a kind of drastic changes in the COVID era that will lead to us to have a kind of, you know, post-COVID era. The way in 1991, I think we all can remember, US became the sole superpower, the global headmaster, the global policeman in 1991 after the disintegration of the erstwhile USSR or the Soviet Union. After 1991, the world men have witnessed a new order, right? A new world order, which started being dictated by the United States of America, and which has still been going on, of course, with renewed, you know, interpretations and discussions on the issue. In that way, today also, we have the connotations like post-COVID era in national context or post-COVID world order in international context. My point is that, as has been given in the title itself, that is post-COVID era, I think, you know, this has also, you know, somehow made some leaders to be a kind of global leaders who, you know,
gave these kinds of connotations like post-COVID era. We all know that it was Trump, Putin, and then the premier of China, including our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, if you can remember, that they actually told us about post-COVID era. And while pronouncing the COVID for the first time, it also showed some kind of power while uttering the, that's my point, right? So definitely, as I told, the biggest challenge, that is the COVID-19, has accentuated us to think of a kind of, you know, dynamics which we can witness in the post-COVID era, post-COVID order, right? Now the point is that in this post-COVID era, definitely there will be changes. Now, what sort of changes we will be witnessing? This is a question of crores. Who will be leading the world? Whether India will be a part of the global power, whether India can somehow dictate with its economy in the global order. Now, you have number of questions to be addressed while, you know, uttering the frame post-COVID era and the position of women, I mean, position of India, right? So, this is a question of course, as I have already told you, and India must have to think and must have to work hard to get its due share and to get its position in the order to witness, I mean, in the post-COVID world order or in the post-COVID era. Now, as I have already told, that it was Trump, the prime president of US, Putin, then you have the premier of China. They have been somehow, you know, dictating the this way or that way, the very dynamics of this COVID era. We have seen how there has been a kind of trade war between China and United States of America. Right? Therefore, some people started telling about post-COVID era. In other words, post-COVID world order or post-COVID world design. I mean, these are the frames as of now which have been used. Now, you know, just to understand these dynamics, I think I need to make you understand what exactly necessitated us to think that there will be a kind of post-COVID and that will be bringing number of changes. Right? And for that reason, we need to understand the background. And what is the background? We all know that by January 2020, Chinese government, you know, Chinese government brought an information into the custody of the World Health Organization that it has found a kind of new disease which is not at all similar with the existing diseases, and that's why it needs utmost caution in the international arena. Health organizations like World Health Organization. And from then time onwards, the whole world became somehow conscious about the new trend of diseases, more particularly the COVID-19 and its, you know, symptoms, its, you know, mechanisms to combat the same. These were the discussions after January 2020. The point is that, you know, to deal with COVID-19 situation, what China did it actually, you know, started locking down the cities, particularly Wuhan, in the first and subsequent centers, right? Social distancing, wearing of masks. Very interestingly, you will find it very interesting that these are in fact the tactics being followed globally to combat or to check the spread of COVID-19. Very interesting. The tactics which were developed by China and which were informed before WHO, now under the approval of the WHO, these norms, these tactics which were being followed or which are being followed by China has now been the global tactics. So my point is that, my first point is that China became the forerunner in making its own tactics to check COVID-19 as the global tactics. Number two, what we have seen is that now, to a certain extent, Chinese economy has been normalized. Now China economy being normalized, China is now quite normal in the sense that it had the first experience and now it can, you know, now it can, it has been seeing the path to get normalized economy to the world, to the global partners. So here lies the question. From 1991, the state which became the global dictator, which became the global headmaster, I mean the US, that US to a certain extent has been superseded by the China. In what context? In the context of, you know, making its own tactics as the global tactics to, you know, combat, I mean, COVID-19. And second thing is that its economy now has been normalized to a certain extent, which is being followed by other countries. So China has become forerunner in this context. And this has actually accentuated us to the issues like the frames like New World Order. Had this been led by US, then I think this would have not been in the forefront. This, I mean, the leadership has been taken now by some other countries, or country other than the US. And that actually has made us to think about a kind of new world order to be achieved, if it is all after the COVID-19 pandemic, when it is, the pandemic is over. So it has been the background, you know, that China was, or China has been leading in this context, at least the context which has been developed by COVID-19. And it has been led by a country other than the global superpower, the United States. And that is quite interesting to understand the context of China while understanding the dynamics of COVID-19. Right? Now, the other thing that I wanted to share with you is, you know, the normal economy which has been developed by China, on the other extent, if not total, on the other hand, what we have seen in the context of United States of America, we have seen that United States of America got a setback in the 9/11 attack. Right? 9/11 attack has been one of the severe threats to United States of America. It got the taste of terrorism, which was the first of this kind to be tested by United States of America, right? So now, and for that reason, it started, entering a kind of war against terror. Then again, we have seen how in 2008, because of the global recession, United States of America got a setback economically. We have also witnessed how United States of America has concentrated on its domestic politics, on its issues of migration, issues of citizenship, right? And it has of late, it has curtailed its fund for World Health Organization. So my point is that COVID-19 in the immediate setback for the United States of America, but there has been a kind of setback to some extent for the United States of America, which got started basically on or after 9/11 attack, right? So the point that I wanted to make is that at one hand, the global headmaster was getting a kind of setback. On the other hand, you had the China, because of the outbreak of it got a new shape. It got a kind of, it got a kind of new arena to enter into the main politics in the world so that it can be followed by other countries. Maybe United States of America. So my point that I wanted to make is that because of these developments, ultimately, and the top of cutting funds from World Health Organization by United States of America, this has been a kind of step towards multilateralism, right? So this has been the background under which we have been to, we are to understand the dynamics of post-COVID world order in international arena and post-COVID era, you can say, both in national and international. Now, giving this background, I am now coming to Indian context. And to understand India's context also, we need to understand how, how India has been dealing with United States of America and the Chinese. I'll give you some of the developments to make you understand my points. First, the Trump administration requested Indian government to send hydrochloroquine as a medicine to deal with COVID-19. And we have seen through media how this can also be turned as a kind of threat. To India, that you need to send the hydrochloroquine, right? So, I mean, it was a kind of order on the part of US before India to send the hydrochloroquine. My point is that this has ultimately made us to think the aspects in other way around us. My first point, I mean, the first example I have to give. On the other hand, we have seen how, India and China got a kind of irritational relationship. We know that India has been having, different sorts of relations. We had in 1962, we had the battle. Then now also we had this turmoiling situation of the, So my point is that India is having a relationship with China. On the other hand, in terms of democratic temperament, and United States of America has been the mother of democratic countries. So, I mean, from that sense, United States of America, India, they were having relationships, good relationship, one or after Rajiv Gandhi. And now that India, as dictated by USA, send the Toro Queens to US. It's very interesting. On the other hand, we have a kind of very, you know, irritational relationship between India and China. So under this backdrop, you know, it is the task on India, part of India, to decide what to be done. Because it's a kind of evolving situation. It's not static, or it has not yet emerged. It is yet to be emerged. I mean, it's evolving. It's not evolved. So in an evolving situation, it's very difficult where to give our footprints or how to leave our footprints. It's very interesting. So in a very fluctuating situation, at one hand, you just had international relationship with China. And on the other hand, you have the dynamics of Pakistan and United States of America. So under such circumstances, some of the scholars already in the video, so now we have seen how to proceed with its footprints. I mean, how India proceed in this evolving situation. So I will be coming to this point later on. But as of now, what I can say that India should not follow any of the, you know, giants, I mean the leaders, neither China nor United States of America. I will be coming to that. Now, you also remember that in between we had the meetings of SAARC, meetings of NAM, right? So India very categorically mentioned that SAARC has very important role to play in case of taking COVID-19. On the other hand, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi has also categorically urged the G20 countries to bring reforms, to have innovations for World Health Organization. My point is that somehow India has been finding a way through multilateralism by giving importance to both SAARC also. Although we know that NAM, I mean the non-aligned movement which got emerged as a response to the Cold War, and the Cold War has no way there after 1991, literally. But the point is that it has also to do a lot in these new decades. Because you all know, although there has not been, you know, imperialism, colonialism, but new forms of India, and it legalized somehow the role of, or it has formalized, it has necessitated the role of NAM country, NAM, the forum of NAM, to deal with the new changes, the new acts. So my point is that at one hand, we have seen how United States of America had somehow, you know, cutting its fund from, World Health Organization. On the other hand, it is India which has been giving importance to these multilateral organizations. Now, what is it in domestic field? Now I'm coming to the domestic field. See, India, after COVID-19, had took its shape in India. I mean, after COVID-19 has developed its devastating role in India, particularly India as a state and India government has done as of now. We need to understand that. The very question that the organization, I mean, the organizers framed, that is prospects and challenges for India in post-COVID era. To understand this, the first and foremost thing that we need to keep in mind is that how India deals the COVID-19 pandemic, right? What is the role of India in dealing with the COVID-19 situations? How India emerges after COVID-19, right? So this is the most important aspect to deal with the prospects and challenges, whatever I mean, India's position in post-COVID. Now, in this context, some statesmen or some scholars, they argue that, you know, India must go with multilateral setups or forums. Some say that no, India should be with the regional organizations like we have SAARC, ASEAN. On the other hand, some other scholars and statesmen, they argue that India first fix its own, you know, kind of, kind of strategy which is being developed by China and United States of America. I mean, it's bilateral relationship with US and China. So I think to understand all this, I mean, India's role in bilateralism, in regionalism, in multilateralism, first of all, we need to understand exactly have been the strategies being forwarded or strategies being developed by India while dealing with COVID-19 pandemic. What we have seen as of now, that in most of the countries of the world, there has been a kind of unprecedented expansion of government power. India has not also been the exception in this regard. So, unprecedentedly, we have witnessed how the government power is expanding. And people, they have been subjugated in most of the countries, in some of the countries of the world. Right? So if we go through the different contexts, regional contexts of the world, we have seen that this tendency of becoming, I mean, the governments to become more powerful has been one of the aspects, newly developed aspects of the country. So, you know, in this new context, I mean, where you have unprecedented expansion of government power, definitely, that may slightly, you know, reduce the civil liberties on the part of the people. Number two, there has been a kind of increasing number of surveillance on the part of the people, on the part of the subjects. So this has, on the other hand, made us to think differently, right? There has been subjugation. Say, for example, the way we had the lockdown, our movements have been restricted throughout the world, more or less, in India also. So somehow, these have subjugated our rights, number one. And number two, we may also say there has been voluntary subjugation. There has been voluntary subjugation, which is very interesting and very important. There has been voluntary subjugation on the part of the people because of this newly developed situation created by COVID-19. Right? So the surveillance, subjugation, and voluntary subjugation. On the other hand, we have seen because of this over on the part of the governments, there has been authoritarian style of governance to some extent, which in fact is against civil liberties. Right? So my point is that at one hand, we had all these, you know, kind of massive, you know, harassments because of this lockdown, right? Of course, which was to curb the menace of COVID-19, to curb the spread of COVID-19. The point is that because of lockdown, because of restriction in our movements, because of the, you know, sudden stop on this economic activity, our whole life became stagnant. Whole life became stagnant. We have seen the incidences in the, I'm referring the context of India. We have seen what has happened in, you know, in Mumbai, Anand Vihar, right? In case of reverse migration on the part of the leaders, right, on the part of the workers, it ultimately necessitated us to think beyond what has been thought, right? So it has been, as Shivani also in her initial remark, she has also rightly pointed out that, you know, this has been a kind of menace for a country like India, where the migrants, the laborers had to migrate from their own working to their native places. They had to come back, and the very pathetic situation which were experienced by them were also witnessed by us. So, this is one of the aspects. On the other hand, I have, you can understand how the civil liberties were curtailed, not necessarily only in India, but elsewhere also we have seen. So my point is that this somehow necessitated us to think that at one hand, you had the curtailment of civil liberty, the spread of COVID-19, right? At the cost of the economy. On the other hand, we had the expansion of government power. So these two aspects ultimately made us, the subjects, the citizens, to suffer a lot. To the spread of COVID-19. So my simple point that I wanted to make is that in the name of checking the spread of COVID-19, governments have been taking or checking their own initiatives, own tactics, strategies. And the role of country, say role of a single nation state in terms of initiating studies to curb COVID-19 will determine its own position in the new world order or in the new COVID era. So in this context, I just wanted to argue, place my opinion that, you know, India needs to conceive, or India needs to, you know, think in a way so that it can reboost its economy. India needs to focus more on economy, which has been in devastation because of, you know, COVID-19. And there were debates even before COVID-19 also, whether there were slowdown in economy or not. I mean, we have extensively read on all these. We have seen, and COVID-19 also come in a very rapid way to, you know, to make our economy more devastating. Now the point is that it depends upon the Indian, depends upon the policy decision of Indian government how to rejuvenate India's economy, right? And to deal to that, to rejuvenate India's economy, definitely India must have to have proper planned policies, which will be looking after all the aspects, which will be all inclusive, which will be the reverse migration issue. We all know that this migration issue has brought number of challenges for us, which in fact are new challenges, which in fact are the challenges for our economy, for our industrial sector, for our MSMEs. So these MSMEs are also dying to some extent. The big industries, the big business groups, they are also to some extent in great problem. So my point that I wanted to make is that India first needs to focus to revamp its own economy, to rejuvenate its economy, right? And then we can show the world that we have, you know, developed our economy to a certain extent, and then it can play its role in the global arena. So the point that I wanted to make is that this, you know, unprecedented developments these developments need to be carefully assessed, and proper policies must have to be taken. On the other hand, we have seen in case of India also, as many scholars have written on this, that during this pandemic, while dealing with the COVID situation of COVID-19, somehow India became less federal. Right? We had frequent meetings between the Prime Minister and the Chief Ministers. But I think meetings between and among the Chief Minister would have also been very fruitful in this regard. And on the other hand, we have seen that, you know, parliamentary committees or the parliament was also not called for session. I mean, with all these, I just wanted to show that at one hand, you had all these issues, right? On the other hand, we somehow had a very stagnant opposition, right? So the all devastating situation that we had to face somehow were not well reflected by, or somehow left to be reflected by the opposition, particularly Indian National Congress and others. Right? My point is very simple, that on the one hand, we had all these problems. On the other hand, you had the expansion of government power, not only in India, elsewhere also. And parallelly, we didn't have a very remarkable role being played by opposition. So all these ultimately made us to think that we had to have much more concrete and comprehensive inclusive policies. We have seen how, you know, this COVID-19 pandemic has exposed our inequalities, our injustice, right? Our inequal tendencies caste, color, language, religion, all these got developed by that time. We have seen, right? So these has exposed, COVID-19 has exposed all these, you know, injustice, the exclusiveness of politics, these have been exposed. Right. On the other hand, see, now you have Shining India. I often give this example. We had this Shining India at one hand, on the other hand, you have this. So Shining India and this struggling Bharat. See this, I mean, just I am relating COVID-19 with this frame. We need to understand that socialism is not being practiced. And we know that through this practice, we can somehow, as has been, you know, as has been approved by World Health Organization, through this we can spread the, we can check the spread of COVID-19. But equally, we know that to maintain social distance is so much problematic for people who are within this take that is struggling Bharat, right? So social distancing may not be so much applicable. We have seen, right, when the we have seen Anand Vihar and in other places as media has been revealing, both regional and national media, that, you know, these are very much problematic. So here lies the most important point that I wanted to make, that the policies being taken or to be taken to deal with COVID-19 or to deal with post-COVID era, it should be very much inclusive. It should be integrated, cohesive. Otherwise, the very nature, the way we have been exposed, that will be continued, right? So the point that I wanted to make is that the poor have been the victims in this COVID-19 pandemic, right? They are more victims than the rich, particularly in Indian context, right? Of course, particularly in the urban poor context. Now we have seen how this pandemic has been reaching to the rural poor also. In case of Assam also, now it has been penetrating towards the, you know, remotest places, to the, you know, rural areas of Assam, other places of India too. So this, I mean, the policies to be taken or being taken must address this social inclusivity or social justice. Otherwise, India's position in post-COVID era will be somehow being will be accompanying problems, right? So these issues must have to be taken into account while dealing with COVID situation and to foresee post-COVID situations. Now, that's why, you know, our investments, I mean, under such backdrop, where we need to invest. By investment, I'm not, you know, I don't mean only economic investment, you know. You know, the whole pandemic has highlighted our shortcomings and failures. We all have seen, right? There are opportunities also, as we have seen, healthcare facilities, particularly for to deal with COVID, we have given utmost care and importance. I mean, the healthcare, education, social security, these are the areas where we need much more concentration. And then only we can prosper. And somehow this COVID-19 pandemic has showed us in other way that these are the areas, give emphasis on all these areas. Otherwise, we cannot simply prosper in the new normal time. I mean, in the post-COVID era. Right? So, first of all, to do it, I mean, to address these issues, people of India must have to be taken in confidence. I'm just in this regard, I want to give an example of Amartya Sen. I think you you can also recall that after demonetization, giving an example to bring Amartya Sen in this context. Just after demonetization, he has said demonetization has in a way brought mistrust, right? It has brought mistrust and less confidence among the Indians. Right. So in this way, my point in this context is that we need to focus on inclusive, comprehensive, cohesive, integrated policies to deal with the situation, but taking the people in confidence. If we don't take the people in confidence, we cannot. So therefore, the effects of lockdown and the effects of corona pandemic, this has brought number of changes. It has exposed the inequality, injustice, and it's the great time, the best time to invest in these issues, to invest concentration on these issues. That's my point, right? So, my point, as I told, a comprehensive roadmap must have to be taken up to deal with the health and economic consequences of this. Health, where I have already told that healthcare, education, social security, these areas must have to be given utmost consideration. And this investment will only determine, this investment will determine India's position, right? Both in terms of opportunities and challenges in giving its footprint, in providing its footprint in the future order, may it be in domestic arena or in international arena, right? So basically, the issues, or these have been the issues where we need to give our concentration. At last, I would like to bring your attention to the very promising frame, the connotation that our Prime Minister has uttered, that is Atmanirbhar, self-reliant India. So that self-reliant India, the very context of self-reliant India, is very promising. We know that after the coming of this government in 2014, BJP-led government, 2014, they introduced a new connotation, that is, or new policy, that is, Make in India. And we know that during that time we had a kind of debate in between Make in India and Made in India. And somehow today, that context is missing. The situation has made us, think another way, right? So my point is that today you have the, slowbalization, deglobalization. So the point is that today the borders are in utmost importance. We have become now bordered citizens. But after 1991, the border we had started, that somehow, gave very less importance to the borders. So now today we have become bordered citizens. On the other hand, you have kind of state sovereignty, which has been given utmost importance. So under such backdrop,
I think Atmanirbhar Bharat is very promising. But while understanding Atmanirbhar Bharat, I think we need to focus on the economic connotation of development, particularly in case of rural areas. See, we have welfare connotation, we have economic connotation, political connotation of rural development. I'm just relating the cases. So this welfare mechanism is very much of short term, we all know. But economic connotation in long run can play its role. So therefore, under such circumstances, being developed by COVID-19 pandemic, right? We need to focus on, you know, kind of, my point is that we need to focus on this economic connotation of development, which must be very much both short-term and long-term policies, right? I mean, Indian people, particularly the rural poor and the urban, I mean, the middle class and the lower middle class and the lower class must have to be taken into account. So the economic policies, which are very much of long-term, which need to long-term purposes along with the short-term if there is necessary. Otherwise, we have seen that somehow there has been concentration of public policies on the welfare mechanism. Welfare is much more important, but in the long run, economic creation of development is much more important than the welfare connotations. Right? So, under such circumstances, during the time of, you know, deglobalization, because most of the scholars, other statesmen, we have seen they have been arguing that we are now in a kind of arena where there is deglobalization. Whether there is deglobalization or not, that is a debatable one, but we can safely say that corona pandemic has brought a kind of massive challenges for the new liberal setup for globalization also. So under such circumstances, India as a nation must have to have its own kind of its own view, own vision to deal with the situations. Right? My point is that in such a situation, what we need to do, in such a situation, what we need to do, as I initially told you, that whether India should look at China led world order, US led world order, or any sort of other world order to be witnessed with other actors, international actors, and which in fact will be multilateral in practice. So my point is, I just again want to argue that now this battle is not between between the leadership of US and the China, right? But it's not a development between Trump and Xi. My point is that this is a kind of new situation where, first of all, we need to stand of our own. And then we need to very carefully forward our steps. As now, things are very fluctuating. I have already told initially, things are very hypothetical. But still, India as a state must have, I mean, according to India, should forward
through the multilateral organizations. Right? India should foresee a kind of global order which will be multiple in nature. Otherwise, we have seen that the bipolar world order from 45 to 91, India had to deal with as a new infant. Just after, you know, we all know that in 1947, India got its independence, and India got its independence in a situation when the whole world got divided into two blocks, the capitalist bloc and the communist bloc, and India had to have its own strategy. So India had experience. Now we don't know what, you know, world order will be following, what world order will be missing after the pandemic is over. But India state, I think, must have to have its own stand. And it needs to be importance on the multilateral body. It needs to have good relationship with our neighbors. We have seen the turmoil in relationship with our neighbors, but I think as a student of political science, I do feel that there must have a kind of strategic relationship between and among our neighbors to provide its needs. And the important point that I told you is that with domestically, India is thinking that, you know, India needs to ensure that a very cohesive, integrated, inclusive policy is taken for development, and, you know, through that policy, India gets its attention in development other than any other superficial issues. So I think in that way, as I already told, that, you know, if we wish to play a leadership role and to, you know, and to present a kind of vision for a more inclusive world, and which is being defined by international cooperation, then we need to back it with our own example. I mean, India needs to set its own example through concentration on domestic effort in international. Obviously, it depends on will you emerge as a part of the problem or as a part of the solution. It depends, right? So these are the issues, whether India emerges as a part of the problem or as a part of the solution. Will we emerge weaker or stronger as a nation? What will be our efforts for inclusive India? So I think these are the issues where we need to focus on, and these can give us answer on the very prospects and challenges for India in the post-COVID era. So here I end my presentation. I'll be happy to address the, you know, queries being, raised by our attendance. Thank you very much. Thank you to the academic fraternity of Borhula College for giving me this opportunity to express my views on this very pertinent issue, which in fact is very much hypothetical, which in fact is very much fluctuating. Thank you. Thank you so very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. You have stressed in your discussion the reinterpretation of world order, and you have also stressed on the India's role in international order, particularly after COVID-19 era. Your discussion explicit that in many countries, an authoritarian regime has been emerged. Also, you have highlighted that civil liberties are being subjugated, exploiting the situation of COVID-19 period. We have highlighted to regenerate our economy despite many challenges, and Indian government must have to take a inclusive policy to combat this present situation. Thank you, sir, for your presence, and you have explicitly discussed the matters, perspective, and challenges for India in post-COVID-19 era. Now, I hand it over this to our coordinator, IQC coordinator, Dr. Annabura, to start question and answer session.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, honorable resource person. Now, I would like to request all the participants to raise their questions. In our Zoom meeting, they can put their question directly here. I'd like to request all the participants their questions. Please.
Now, I'd like to request all the participants to raise their questions.
If anybody wants to know from our honorable resource person, Dr. Barun Day, sir, please ask your, put your question, please.
Sir, here is my question. Sir, are you audible to me, sir?
Yes, please.
Sir, when the pandemic was started in Wuhan province, many international companies were left from China, but unfortunately, those companies, a little company has come to India, and many multinational companies were gone to Vietnam, Taiwan, Japan, even Myanmar too. And you have discussed that to start up India, make in India, and Atmanirbhar Bharat. How could we face this problem?
Yes, that's why, you know, thank you so much for your question. And, you know, you are right. And the point that I made is that you had initially had much debate on Make in India and Made in India. And somehow this situation has minimized that very context, the debate between Make in India and Made in India. Because of the new changes, you have the connotations like deglobalization, globalization. So the companies, they, you know, came back from China, as you have mentioned, that they didn't come to India, but elsewhere they went to else countries. So my point is that here is the very essence of India in terms of its policies and in terms of its implementation of the policies, right? So it must have to have some strategies. I mean, how India will be dealing with this issue of bringing the companies here in Indian territory in the pretext of Atmanirbhar Bharat, right? Atmanirbhar Bharat, we all have seen how the Prime Minister of Narendra Modi has given importance on the vocal for local, right? So in this context, we have to think of our own local industries, MSMEs, and all the other sort of policies we need to have to deal with the foreign companies. What sort of, you know, policies do we need to have for FDI, foreign direct investment in retail sector and in wholesale sector, right? What sort of policies you have for Make in India or Made in India? I think you have rightly, you know, raised this issue. And this, as I told you, that it depends on India's policy, right? And also, a very concrete policy decision must have to be taken, right, to deal with these issues. And I think, the question of Atmanirbhar Bharat will become much more promising, will be much more helpful for India, provided a concrete shape is shown a very concrete, I know, kind of very concrete policies are being formulated. Keeping in view the other context, the issue you raised, the foreign companies and our own companies. So very likewise, you know, raising this issue. Thank you so much.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I'd like to put one question from chat box from Zoom. Dr. Rabindra Bordoloi has asked this question. How would you look about the scientific origin of COVID-19? What is your views on the development of COVID vaccine? Actually, from scientific or health background.
Yeah. This is not that much related with this topic that I,
yes.
I mean, as a student of political science, I think. Yes. But yet, yes. I know there are controversies, there are different debates from different corners, and we need to go through all these before, you know, having our own conclusion on that. Thank you. And the next question is coming from Anjali Chowdhury, I think.
Yes,
our own student from our department.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I have a question. Why did the banning of some of the Chinese apps took place before 2021 election? Is it a new vote bank policy for the present government?
Yes,
we had much debates on this while you know banning this kind of Chinese apps, and these you should not see in isolation. You know, as I already told, that there was a kind of trade deal between United States of America and China. And now that trade deal has somehow been forgotten, and now you have a trade war in between between China and at one hand, and on the other hand, United States of America. And you had this kind of border irritational relationship between India and China. And in that context, in that context, background, you know, Indian government decided to ban some of the Chinese apps. So my basic point is that, you know, that was immediately taken in context of the relationship that we got, irritational relationship that we got developed because of all those issues you all are familiar with. Now, whether these may have bearing in the next election or not, you know, these Chinese products and all, these have been there in public parlance for a couple of years. You know, the issue of Chinese products have been there in our political parlance for a couple of years, we have seen. Now, whether these may be there in the election or in the next election or not in 2021, I think we have, in case of Assam or in other states like West Bengal and all. So, you know, the basic point is that, you know, China, in China also, we have seen that the majoritarian rule, somehow we can see that the majoritarian rule has been going on, right? Where the government is very much powerful. You see United States of America, very much powerful. India, in India also. Government is very powerful from that sense. So I'm just, you know, trying to, you know, break the isolation, or, you know, I'm just, if you want to bring this phenomenon into a perspective, then definitely these developments may have bearing in the elections, definitely. Because as I have already pointed out, that there has been unprecedented expansion of power on the part of the national governments. We have seen in United States of America, US, maybe in India also. So these may determine the future fate of elections or political calculations or political activities. So definitely this may also be used, right? So definitely, you know, if you think from that sense, then, you know, these things, maybe they are in politics. But as of now, these are very much hypothetical, right? Thank you so much, Anjali. Thank you so much for your question. I think you got your answer.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. And one question from from YouTube also and from Zoom also, same question. I think from Sarnali Bhattacharya. He wants to know about what do you think that due to the outbreak of coronavirus on China, will the import dependence on China have a major impact on the Indian industry in near future?
Yeah, so the larger issue that you have raised is the global supply chain. Yes. We all know that we were dependent on China. Even United States of America was also to some extent, for some cases, it was dependent on China. And the global companies, they have been going back from China. So this global supply, I mean, there has been a setback or there has been a kind of, now there has been a kind of vacuum in, you know, global supply chain, in supply chain. And to get a normalized, normalized kind of situation in regard to global chain, global supply chain, definitely it will take time. It may take a decade or half decade or a total decade. But in between, definitely, you know, after, the time when there will be a kind of new supply chain, global supply chain, we'll be having a new supply chain, and for that we need to wait. But before that, in the immediate time, I mean for 2 years, 3 years, by the time the world gets a new global supply chain, China will be dictating. Because as you have said that the outbreak of coronavirus in import in dependence on China have a major impact on Indian industries in near future. Yes, there may be, and that's why, I mean, in that context, you know, we have this, you know, Atmanirbhar, we can contextualize it in the context of Atmanirbhar Bharat. But the point is that by the time we have new global supply chain, China definitely will have its own say to a certain extent, if not total. And definitely that will, you know, that will have bearings on the nation states. And it will have bearings, it will have influence in the import dependence on China on the part of India too. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your valuable question. Actually, one question, more question from YouTube, from Tapos Devnath wants to know about how the problematic issues can be resolved during the post-COVID-19 era in the light of industrial development with the pace of Make in India policy.
Will you repeat the question, please?
Yes. How the problematic issues can be resolved during the post-COVID-19 era in the light of industrial development with the pace of Make in India policy?
Your voice is not coming. Just repeat it.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Actually, Tapos Devnath wants to know how the problematic issues can be resolved during the post-COVID-19 era in the light of industrial development with the pace of Make in India policy.
Yeah. So, as I already told that, you know, this Make in India and this Atmanirbhar Bharat, these are somehow, I mean, you can relate it from one sense. So definitely for industries, maybe big industries or for MSMEs, it was a total setback for them. There was total lockdown. There was, you know, complete lockdown of the companies, complete lockdown of the, you know, factories. And on the other hand, what we have seen that the reverse migration, and this reverse migration somehow again, you know, necessitated, you know, the companies concerned to rethink. From one sense, they were in setback for the lockdown of their companies. On the other hand, the available laborers they had, now these laborers are not there within their territory or within their own, the quote unquote box. Now they are in their, I mean the migrants, they have migrated to their own native places. So in this context, as I already told that this whole episode is a setback both for the big companies, big business, as well as for the MSMEs. And MSMEs have been victimized. So now government of India has taken some reform measures, and they claimed that it is their own version that, you know, through these reforms, they can revamp the broken Indian economy. So now we have seen that in China, industries have been reopened, and in India also, to some extent, normalization process got started, right? So now in this context, the question of Make in India, whether that will be appropriate or not, or Made in India, as I told, you know, whether these will be a kind of quite, these will be in conformity with the present situation of India or not. I think there must be, as you know, Raghuram Rajan has also said in an interview to NDTV, that a trust must have to be developed between, you know, in case in regard to the big businesses. And for MSMEs, there must be huge investment. Government of India must have to give huge money loan to the MSMEs. And we have seen the government of India has somehow given funds to the MSMEs also. So on 28th August 2020, whether these will be leading, these policies of government of India, the policies being taken up by government of India will lead India to a kind of industrial friendly India, keeping in view the context that whether companies from outside India are coming or not, because you have FDI, foreign direct investment, both in retail and wholesale sector. And on the other hand, how can we develop our own MSMEs? Say in Assam, we have number of MSMEs. So how can they get their footprints in the post-COVID time? So all these, we need to wait and see. As of now, the policy that has been taken by India, taken by the government, both by central as well as the state governments, there are a number of suggestions by different economists, by different academicians. Now the point is that the policies being taken by India, as you have asked, whether they can serve the purpose or not, I think we need to wait and watch. We need to wait and watch, and then only we can say the policies being taken up, as of now, the policies being taken up, whether they can serve the purpose or not. But I think we should not see all these in isolation. There has been the global context, and we need to understand it from global perspective as well as from national perspective. The person who asked the last question has also had such types of apprehensions, So we need to understand these in global context and in national context. Thank you so much.
I want to one question, sir. I want to. My question, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes.
May I ask, sir?
Yes. I'm getting you.
Sir. Hello.
Yeah, I'm getting you.
Sir. So I think what is the impact on the lower businessmen?
Yes.
Number of trades we cancel with China. Small businessmen, we bring some twice colors medicines for the lower persons. All yes, things yes. are canceled by from the China trading. What is the impact of?
Yeah. So the point, that's why I told that, this pandemic has brought sea changes in the entire life, in entire fields of human life, right? And the very economy that got devastated globally as well as in context of India. We have seen how the, you know, local business groups and the medium business groups, they were in problem, including the big businesses, right? And the context you categorically mentioned, the way the, you know, the, you know, supply chain got a kind of reinterpretation, the supply chain from abroad got a kind of, you know, whether I should use the word setback or not, but the thing is that, you know, the mobile phones, the handsets we used to purchase by 8,000, 10,000, 12,000, now you need to pay additional 3,000, 4,000. This has been very much practical. If you go to the shops and you can understand it, you can witness it. So the point is that, you know, these issues have been there. They are the most sufferers, particularly the business groups. I mean, the medium and small business groups, in different ways. Because of the, at one end, because of the lockdown, their establishments are closed. Number two, after opening of the establishments also, now, what about their, you know, what about their own purchasing? They are not in a way to purchase the way, number one, and number two, for consumers also. For consumers also, it has been a great problem because, you know, like healthcare, you know, like healthcare also, here you can relate it, healthcare and business. I mean, you have enormous problems on the part of the big, small and medium business groups. They are having problem in terms of their own, you know, supplies. I mean, in terms of their own, you know, purchasing. Once they finish selling their products, they are not in a way to regain their products. This has been a situation also I have personally witnessed while going to the market. So the very issue you raised, this has been the question of our own situation, and that is the real reflection. I already told that some of the economists, they have suggested program, we have heard their own views that, you know, we need to take all these business groups into trust. And then only they will be in the field, and they can, when they can run their establishments, then they can contribute to the economy. So I think the issue that you have raised is worthy enough, and Government of India, along with the provincial states, provincial government, must put on that, and definitely there must have to have confidence on the part of the business groups, particularly, I mean, business groups, and more particularly the medium and small business groups. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Sir.
Thank you so very much.
Okay.
Sir, I have a query, sir. Sir.
Yeah. Please.
Sir, there has been a lot of conspiracy theory developed in the world. COVID-19 is COVID-19 is a conspiracy theory, and second, should India go to the socialist pattern of society?
Okay. So first one, as you have said, the conspiracy, you know, that has been argued by many corners. So yes, there has been debate. And the debate has been from different corners, more particularly Trump administration has vehemently, you know, said China, and it sets China. I think we all remember. It's a kind of truth or not. You know, that needs time for that. That I can tell you that in the days to come, we can unveil, we can unfold many of the things. And then only we can understand whether it falls under conspiration or not. But it is that, as you know, as I have already told in very initial time, that the tactics which were followed by China now become global tactics. Now in China, economy is much more normal than other countries. So because of all these, some of the countries, particularly United States of America, it categorically threats China on the basis of the issue what you raised. And second thing, whether India should follow capitalist, you know, regime. I mean, whether India, I think you are indirectly asking that whether India should go with China or not. But I already said that it's not fair time to think that whether India should go with China or India should go with United States. Because the frame is yet to be decided. The world order is yet to be decided. We are predicting that we may lead a world order which will be dictated by China. And whether we are going to have a kind of world order which will just be the continuation of the US-led world order, or whether we are going to have a kind of world order which will be led by other countries, which in fact will be a multipolar. And in this way, you have speculations. Now, to answer your question, I don't think that at this point of time, India should think that whether it should go for China or United States of America. But it's time to focus on India's own possibilities. It's time to focus on how to deal with the challenges being posed by COVID-19 situation. And then India should decide when there will be a kind of, I mean, when there will be some mobilization, then India should think. I mean, first, as Swami Vivekananda said, that be and make. So first, I intend to tell that India now should focus on its domestic issues. From true sense, India needs to give utmost importance to the very issues, to the very devastations we had experienced, we have witnessed. And then it needs to think of how to, you know, leave footprints in the international area. So I think that will be a kind of wise decision on the part of India. It's not the proper time to think or to decide on this. Thank you,
sir. You have answered all the questions very in expressive way, in very simple language. I think to the point wise. Thank you very much, sir. We actually, in your speech, you have touched all the points regarding what should be the India policy after COVID-19 pandemic, and what should be the economic policy, what should be the political policy, and what should be the social policy, and what should be the rule of nation state after COVID-19 period. And we have assumptions. We have made some assumptions for India that we should do, our India should do in this way. Thank you very much for your valuable speech and touching all the points regarding the topic. Thank you very much, sir. Now over to Coordinator Marilyn Hussein Bordes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your enlightenment discussion on this topic. Now I request Mrs. Farida Begum to give her vote of thanks.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Good afternoon. Myself, Farida Begum, Assistant Professor of Borohula College. It is our great pleasure that ultimately we are successfully moving towards in part of the webinar. Prospects and challenges for India is post-COVID-19 era. It was the title of our webinar and first attempt from Political Science Department of our college. As an intellectual practice amidst the becoming innovable environment. As per webinar agenda, at this moment, at the very outset from Department of Political Science, we offered our gratefulness to our Honorable Principal Sir to give opportunity to organize this webinar and many thanks for inaugural speech. We highly appreciate our research person, Dr. Borun De, Assistant Professor of Dibrugarh University for his presence and very informative and valuable speech. Participants are the central point of any program. Without participant means a fruitless attempt. But considering the members of participant, we may proudly say it is a successful webinar. So we offer our grateful to our participant of all over India. Many, many thanks to Dr. Rana Bora, coordinator of IQSC of our college, for his valuable assistance in smooth conduct of our webinar. And same to technical assistant, Rakhnimiranjan Mohanto and Diju Kumar New. At last, we offer our heartfelt gratitude to all of our colleagues for their valuable advice and support. That's all. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Borun De, from my side, and for accepting our invitation. And in spite of your busy schedule, you have given us this time. So thank you very much, Dr. Borun De.
Thank you, Shivani, and to all who are associated with this program. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, our honorable principal sir, and all our staff and colleagues, and especially the political science department for organizing this seminar. On behalf of IQSC Borohula College, on behalf of Borohula College family, I'd like to thank all, and also a special thanks to our honorable research person, Dr. Borun De sir, and our most respected participants attending this webinar from different parts of India and abroad. I'd like to thanks all. And one in information to you, to all of you, especially for the participant, that our feedback link will be shared in WhatsApp and Telegram groups after one hour of this webinar. So this is the information. And with these few words, again, thank you all. And I would like to thank our small technical team also. That team members are working from starting to ending this webinar that is organized by different departments and IQSC from Borohula College, from our technical person, from Devajit Dwara, Rakhnimiranjan Mohanto, and Diju Kumar Neuk sir, and the cooperation from our authority also. Thank you all again. With these few words, I'd like to conclude today's webinar. Thank you.